Just check. Can
Yes,
you
we
see my
can.
screen? Okay, perfect.
Yes, we can. So, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the 59th monthly meeting of the Strongly Sustainable Business Model Group. And as of last count, we have 863 members, which is growing. The pace of growth seems to be increasing, so that must mean we're doing something right, which is good. I'm delighted to welcome back to present to us Nancy Wokin. Nancy presented to us about 3 years ago now on some work that she did on two fronts. One was about patterns of sustainable business models, and it's still some of the most current work in that space, which many of us have been using and applying in our work. And the other was in the area of value generation, not only economically, but socially and environmentally. So Nancy talked to us about 3 years ago on that topic, and you can find those slides in the Dropbox if you're interested. And today she's reporting to us on a whole bunch of things, some of which has been published, some of which I think is underway. So this is an opportunity for us to get a good update on what she's doing. So with that, Nancy, I'll turn it over to you. If you have questions, if you're online, feel free to ask out loud. I'll put them into the chat, and we'll manage those as we can as we go through. Nancy.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you very much, Anthony, for the invitation. It's really great to be part of such a big membership, and it's good to see that the topic is also growing in interest. So, a bit about my background. I'm Nancy Wokin. I'm affiliated with TU Delft, where I'm an associate professor, and next to that, I just got appointed as a professor at Lund University in the area of sustainable business management and practice. So I'm physically moving to Sweden in the summer, but I will stay in touch and affiliated with TU Delft. So you can find me in either of those places. So do let me know when you're visiting. This presentation and this topic was actually born out of some frustration in my research, in my own research, and also in the field of sustainability and the transitions that we should be going to, in my opinion. So a lot of the work that I've personally been involved in, and others have also been doing quite a lot of good work on sustainable business models, has been quite conceptual. And that sort of frustrated me, because there was a big gap between all the good ideas that we were putting forward and the things that we would see in practice. And of course, we see many good tools and methods. But also, what happens then when those tools and methods are being used? So that's how the topic of business model experimentation for sustainability came about. So a brief agenda. So first, I want to explain a bit about the concept, what it means. Then I want to give you some examples and give you some tools and methods, and including a very brief intro to circular economy and how I view it in my research. And then some questions. And those times are indicative, so please feel free to ask questions in between. And if you think that some parts could be explained more or less, do give me a shout. First, very quick, what is business experimentation for sustainability, and why is it so important? When you get literature and practice, it's actually about testing assumptions about a future business and actually collecting some proof to convince people internally in the business, but also externally, about a future business model or future business case. And comparison to a big scale pilot has a lot of advantages, because it's quite low resource, also often low visibility to others in the organization, sometimes even not known to colleagues, and it can be quite low cost. And if it doesn't work, well, you can try something else and continue business as usual. So it's a good way to start practicing.
If we can have a discussion as we're going through, this could be interesting, perhaps. I noticed you're not using any of the terminology to describe exactly the same things that's come out of Silicon Valley. Eric Ries's Lean Startup and Customer Development. No, Eric Ries's Lean Startup and Steve Blank's Customer Development processes. You generalised. Is there an antecedent there for you to that work, or are you building on something else?
No, I'm definitely building on the Lean Startup work. So we'll show some pictures and relations to that work later, and also how I basically use it. So definitely that's work I've looked at also when we try to apply some of these concepts to large organizations. Because there wasn't really a lot out there except Lean Startup. So we'll come to that in a bit. Some of the rationale, but I think this community will know it. Climate change, growing population, the way that business models are set up based on fast product replacement and quick throughput of materials, like we're dependent on quick sales in our business models. So the logic of the business model needs to be changed, which is often perceived as quite radical. So the capability of experimentation and trying to test new business models is very important. We look at sustainable business models, they're quite purpose-driven, involve multiple stakeholders and do environmental and societal value creation on top of economic value creation. So it's also quite a complex thing to pursue in an organization. And experimentation is then about thinking big, but starting small through setting up the first experiments. And what can I do tomorrow to change my business? So it's a key organizational capability, I guess, for any type of business in the future. Some background, so you can see loads of tools and canvases that have been developed. Anthony will recognize his own canvas as well, and I think there's a lot of good work and how we can help businesses using those canvases. Personally, I use this one quite a lot, so it's actually the business model canvas, but then rebuild in one of its most simple forms, and I think it's quite an easy one to use with students. The most basic change that I did to the business model canvas is adding the people, profit, planet value proposition to it, and also clarifying the different elements of the business model visually. Where on the left side we talk about value creation, the right side value delivery, and at the bottom value capture. So it's an easy way to me to explain to students like what are business models about, and then the essence of the business model is the value proposition, which now is created for people, profits, which includes people, profit, and planet now. So that's the main change. But to me, a business model canvas is more about explaining the different elements, like the activities you need to do to change. But on the other hand, you also have the value logic, like why are you in the business and why do you do business in the way you do it? So in the value mapping tool, which I presented a couple of years ago, we have these concepts of value destroyed and value missed. So when businesses think about new things and new opportunities to pursue, rather than think about new opportunities first, they need to become aware of the value destroyed, things that are actively being destroyed for certain stakeholders in the business model, like for instance, pollution and climate change, or the value missed, like failing to capitalize on the resources you have or creating a waste. Those are things that if you become more conscious about it, then it's much easier to think about new opportunities. So that's really the logic of business model innovation. So to me, the previous one is about the different elements to do the delivery, and the value mapping tool can help you with the logic behind the business models. So we've done some reiterations and also in the looks of the business, the value mapping tool, and this is the latest version that we came up with. The basic concept is still the same, but I think visually it's slightly more engaging, so feel free to use this version in the future.
Nancy, I think most people in the room, only a few were here when you presented this back to us originally, so if you feel you have the time, it would be good to spend a moment or two just explaining the basic idea. I think that would be helpful.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't want to be repetitive, but so the value mapping tool is basically developed to do sustainable business modeling, so to develop new sustainable business models. So it has a couple of rings which represent brainstorms. But first of all, when you start thinking about new business models, you start thinking about the purpose, which is the core of this diagram. So the purpose is really, why are you in the business? So when I do these businesses, they often say like, oh, we want to make as much money as possible. But when you look at businesses like Unilever, they might say we're in the business of health and happiness, or a clothing company might say, oh, we want to offer pride and happiness as well. So there's always different types of purposes that a business might provide. And that's the starting point of the value mapping tool. And it has different stakeholder perspectives where environment and society are key stakeholders. Like you can think about NGOs as representatives of these stakeholders. And you go on and think like, what is the current positive value captured? So that's the second brainstorm. And the third and the fourth are really about what is the value actively being destroyed by the business for environment, society. When you think about fizzy drinks, think about the obesity it might create. So as a customer, it might be a thirst-quenching drink, but at the societal level, it might contribute to obesity. So there's often these distinctions that you identify when doing the value mapping tool. And only when you've done that, like the value actively destroyed or the value missed, which might be overcapacity or waste being generated, then you can come to new conclusions on what new business models might be that work better for all the stakeholders in the tool. You may notice when you look at this that there's no stakeholder called company or focal company. We did that on purpose because a company also has different stakeholders. On the one hand, it has the employees, and on the other hand, it has the investors, shareholders, and owners. So those might have quite different dynamics and different stakes in the business. And of course, in the value mapping tool, we try to reconcile those. So it's really a brainstorming tool that will help you rethink your business model by going through those sequential steps. And if people want to know more about it, feel free to contact me. I also have some guides for facilitators that you can use to basically use the tool yourself as well. I hope that helps.
That's good. Thank you.
So now a bit more about the concept of business model experimentation for sustainability. So here you see some pictures of some recent work I've been involved in on this topic. So first of all, writing a book about circular economy, circular business. We started that in 2012, I think, when circular economy wasn't so hyped yet and very not well understood, so to say. So that's how we embarked on this journey with two people from practice as well, and me as the academic. Later on in 2016, we started a kickstarting circular business experimentation project where we basically said, let's just start with a couple of businesses and see how we can put some of the tools and methods around experimentation in practice with businesses so they can start to transition. Homey, we'll talk about it a bit more, but Homey is my own business. It's a startup in pay-per-use appliances, and through the business we want to test new business models and actually also test the impact on the environment and doing some interventions as well to influence customer behavior as well, for instance to reduce the energy use in the home. We'll tell a bit more about that in a bit. And of course, being an academic, I have to do academic publications, so you can see some of the latest publications on this topic too. But here is a picture of sustainable business model experimentation based on the Lean Startup principles by Eric Ries. It's a very simple picture, but basically the difference with Lean Startup is that clearly, there need to be sustainability goals from the outset. And of course, a Lean Startup is for any business and often also more internet-based businesses. So this is maybe slightly different from what it looks like in Eric Ries's book. But the basic principles are still like you start with some ideas for a new business model or a new proposition to the customer. You build a type of model or experiment of such a business model. You collect information and measure the impact of this. With the data, you learn and actually pivot and try some new ideas. So that's a very simple iterative cycle. One of the things that Eric Ries often talks about is A-B split test. A-B split test is where you set up two fake websites, for instance, website A, website B. You may have landed on a page in the past, I have a couple of times, where you click on the web page and it says, sorry, not ready yet, leave your email address and we'll contact you in the future if this service is live. And then that might mean that you got stuck in an A-B split test where a person wanted to check which proposition would be more appealing to put forward, basically. And that's a very simple way of doing experiments and testing whether something could really be a future proposition. So that's just to give you a bit of an idea, but of course there's many more, and I will give you some examples of how we set up experiments in businesses through our projects. But what is business experimentation for sustainability? A lot of text, so I won't read it all out loud, but basically it's different from experimentation in the natural sciences. And when you, as an academic, talk about experimentation with colleagues, it often leads to confusion because they say, what experiments, with whom, with what, with mice, or what are you talking about? But this is really social sciences type of experimentation, and the situation is a lot less controlled than in a normal lab experiment, of course. So it's quite context sensitive, and there's also often diverse possibilities that you can actually could create value from. So you really need to select, because you need to start with something with the key assumptions that are most important to your business. And you cannot control all factors around it, so it's slightly different in that sense from natural sciences. But now, it is systematic.
Nancy, there's a question in the chat from Manuel. He says, could you just define what you mean by business?
Yeah. Mostly I work with for-profit businesses, but also with social enterprises. But I can also see that you would do this with non-profit initiatives, actually. So maybe a better word is organizational experimentation. Personally, I also think that an NGO could test some of their propositions on how they could best approach future donors and things like that. So,
yeah, no, I'll definitely confirm that. I mean, we're running an accelerator at the moment here in Toronto based on this approach, informed by the research of another member on Lean Hoverboom through Lean Flourishing. And in that accelerator, we have almost half of the participants are not-for-profits, and we're applying this experimentation approach.
Yeah. At TU Delta, also work with the initiative around social enterprises. So that's, profit and purpose-driven. So I think that could also be quite viable, quite a viable approach in this sense. So it is systematic. So you start with a hypothesis about the future business, and then you try to identify in which way are we going to test this hypothesis in a business context. So it's quite systematic, can start quite small in different types of ways. The two main things are that it's resource efficient and quite quick, and you don't need to plan many, many things in advance. And yeah, it can lead into a more intensive pilot in the end.
Manuel has just put a couple more questions into the chat there, Nancy. I've got a perspective on those two questions, but what's your perspective?
Which type of business do you see as most receptive to your model? Exxon versus Patagonia. I think Patagonia already does experimentation on a continuous basis. When you look at their book, for instance, they experimented with a zero growth model already. So I think it's in their nature to experiment. I think Exxon will do experiments, but maybe in the sense that I wouldn't like to see them, maybe. So I think it's more the sustainability leaders that would be more receptive to this. But we also did some experiments with laggards or people who don't really know yet how to do it. So, but they need to be up for it and invest the time in doing it. So that's most important.
I think
people who are up for it.
I was going to say, my experience has been that the idea of experimentation, it's not correlated particularly to sustainability goals. So you find some companies who are completely for-profit, they have no sustainability goals whatsoever, and they're very interested in experimentation. And you have other for-profit organizations who are totally uninterested, and the same on the sustainability side. Some of them are very interested in experimentation, and some of them aren't. And it doesn't seem to be correlated particularly to whether or not the goal that the organization has set for themselves.
Yeah. So in the projects that we did, we specifically targeted companies that wanted to focus on circular economy or sustainability. So we didn't force them to do anything they didn't want to do. But for me, I'm not going to spend my time. If people don't want to do any sustainable change, I'm not going to invest my time in them. Well, there's the next question. What about conversion rates, meaning companies that do the experimentation and actually implementing the new business model? Yeah, implementing the new business model. Yeah, what can I say? When is a business model really implemented? I can see that everyone who participated in the process started some form of transformation, either quite small. I think the conversion rate in that sense would be 100%, because they all changed something to the way they do business and all set up new initiatives as a result. So in that sense, you could say it's 100%. But have they disrupted their full business model and changed from A to B? No, that's not the case, because that's, I don't think that business model innovation works like that, that you move from one to the other in a day or so. Yeah. So some examples, just give you a quick overview of some examples, also first from a conference paper and then from some other work. Have you seen the example of Bugaboo and the Flex Plan before? Have you discussed it in an earlier session, maybe? Yeah, so Bugaboo is a company that was, I think, the first to break the $1,000 barrier for baby strollers. So it's quite a high-end brand, I would say. So they make stuff that lasts a couple of generations of children, I would say. So they're basically overspecified for the job, you could say. So maybe the products would last 10, 15 years or so, but they only retrieve value from it once. So they basically have an underexplored second and third hand market, and potentially, yeah, unnecessary resource use if because no child would be in a baby stroller when they're 8 years old, I would say. So there could be a better business model related to this. So they experimented with a flex plan. So you can see all the elements of that. So it was basically a lease plan where you pay a monthly fee, and then maybe if you had another child during the contract period, you could extend and get a wider baby stroller. So the failed value exchange was that the products lasted much longer than the need from the customer, and they wanted to have a flexible product. They were also part of the experimentation project that we did, and we'll talk a little bit more about that, but this was more based on desk research and checking what they did. Unfortunately, the flex plan now got stopped, so but I think they're looking at product redesign and things like that at the moment.
There's a question from Bob.
Yeah. We'll be discussing your approach to measuring. It's not part of this presentation, but I can talk about that in a bit.
So, what was the reason why Bugaboo halted the flex plan? What was the problem or challenge that they ran into?
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to speak on their behalf, but I think it stayed a bit niche. Maybe it was complicated from a product design perspective, because it would involve refurbishing, remanufacturing. I think they wanted to get some maturity around that too. And maybe, and I'm not sure whether that's true, it could attract customer groups that maybe didn't fit with a brand, or maybe had difficulties paying for a product. So those are the things that I guess from other leasing type of models. So there might be a couple of reasons, but at least they tried it, and probably learned a lot in that particular process. Another company I looked at is MudJeans. So it's the first company in the world to lease jeans rather than sell jeans. They came out of a bankrupt business, so there was just a big pile of jeans. And they thought, well, how can we make a sustainable business out of this? So they wanted to revive the business while looking at reducing clothing waste. What they found is that not all customers wanted to lease jeans, surprise, surprise. And I think they also had some issues with collecting payments, because a lot of it went manually initially. So what they now have is two business models. They're only a very small startup, but they both have a buy and deposit system and a lease jeans system. I think they're most famous for the lease jeans system, but probably they get more money out of the buy and deposits and system in that sense. You also see that sometimes you have to have two business models, although the best one from an environmental perspective might be the leasing one. But then the buy and deposit one is the one that you need to have to get more traction with a bigger group of customers. Then the final one is the case of PeerB. So PeerB is a sharing platform in the Netherlands. What they found through their sharing business model is the products break down more quickly when you use them more intensively. There's, of course, a value destroyed when you borrow, when you lend out stuff to others, then you might get it back in a worse shape. So they actually crowdfunded for €1 million to investigate better design of products in the end. So that is what they want to look into now. They have a lot of data on how products are being used, and maybe they want to design better products in the future, which would very much fit their business model of wanting to create long-lasting products that are used by many people. So again, they were successful in the business model, but found flaws and started experimenting with new potential business models to improve the sustainability of their business model. So a lot of my research is also now focused on circular economy. So I just wanted to give you a very, very brief, simple slide on how I see circular economy. It's a very hot topic in Europe. I think it's probably also in North America as well. But circularity to me is really a driver for sustainability. So circular business models and product service systems are also really a subset of sustainable business models. So that's how I see it when I talk about that type of work. Very
unpack the intersection or and the areas that are not intersecting there a little bit. So you're saying that from your perspective, a circular business model doesn't necessarily mean sustainability, and sustainability doesn't necessarily require circular.
The reason that it's not entirely overlapping, and that's how I teach it to the students as well. If you look at circular economy and in a narrow sense in which many people view circular economy at the moment, like it's focused on recycling, closing loops, then you can imagine that you might have adverse effects. If you get very efficient at recycling and remanufacturing, then you sell a lot more stuff, and then maybe the environmental impact improvement is only marginal because you just cycle around quicker and quicker and quicker. So that's more the slow consumption type of idea that is not captured in everyone's view of the circular economy. So that's why it's not fully overlapping with sustainable business models. And similarly, PSS or product service systems, you can imagine product service systems that are unsustainable as well. It's just additional service.
So this is a reflection of how you see people interpreting the words. Okay. Certainly from my own experience, if you don't have circularity, you don't have sustainability. But you're saying you can have circularity and not have sustainability.
Yeah, in principle, but that's more the slow consumption argument. Like if we consume more and more and more in a circular economy, we might need a lot more energy, and then it was all for nothing, basically. So, yeah, but that's just my viewpoint on it. And you can actually also see that in my slides, my brief view on circular economy and how you can see it at the moment. So there's three ways of looking at three elements to circular economy if you just look at the resource flows. So first of all, it's about slowing loops. So making stuff that lasts longer. Think about the Bugaboo example of a baby straw that lasts for 8 or 10 years. And making sure that can be remanufactured and repaired easily. So that's all the strategies in slowing resource loops, making stuff last longer over time. And then the second thing is closing resource loops. So once you've reused, refurbished, remanufactured, repaired, etc., then you have closing loops. And that's really post-consumer use recycling. So that's the closing part of the circular economy. And I think often when people talk about circular economy, they think about that part, like the recycling bit. And then the narrowing flows, so that's the other axis, is about being more efficient. For instance, reducing your energy use in the manufacturing processes and lightweighting products, so using less material per product, for instance. That is already happening in a linear economy. So to me, the most distinctive thing that we should do in the circular economy is, first of all, slowing those resource loops and think about avoidance and reduction strategies first, and then closing the loops as well. So that's sort of my critique as well, or my broader view on circular economy as well. Hope that sort of makes sense. So just a little slide on why I think it has gained so much traction as a concept in Europe, China, many places, also the US, I would say, and Canada as well. It's about money. There's the word economy in it. It sounds like there will be cost savings, new revenue streams, also hedging against future price shocks if you keep hold of the materials, for instance, and can remanufacture. Resources, it's about a way of sustainable development and raw material security, and those things are very tangible. Like, you suddenly cut out all the complicated other parts of sustainability. It's focused on resources and economy. But then when you look at the EU reports on circular economy, there's also can be a way of attracting new customers, but also a way of creating new jobs, becoming an attractive employer in the future. There's also a lot of legislation hinting at circular economy developments, and also it can be a source for innovation in the future. So I think those are the things that businesses are mentioning now that I find exciting about circular economy as a popular topic, basically. So that's why some of the projects I will mention will also have a circular economy feel to it. For instance, this one, kickstarting a circular business
experimentation. Manuel has a question for you.
It's closer to, would you say that it's B Corp is closer to the circular economy? Yeah, benefit corporations. Closer to the ideal of a circular or sustainable economy. I think, while our other businesses are not set up around delivering those purposes, I think a benefit corporation does capture those benefits to society, environment in an effective way. So while we don't have that captured in limited or publicly trading company, I think it could be a good solution in the meantime. Benefit corporation. So the kickstarting circular business experimentation project, we started it in 2016.
Sorry, Nancy, we actually have two B Corps in the room. So what's your interpretation, Bob and Andrew, of how the benefit corporation concept relates to circular economy?
Bob, you go first. I got to ponder that for a while.
Sorry?
Bob, you're on mute, I believe. We seem to have lost you, Bob, there just for a second. Hi. Andrew, any additional thoughts?
I can't capture it.
And I think Ian is typing something related to this, I suspect, but Andre also has a question for you there.
Yeah, I can see it's like, what is your view on circular economy and decoupling growth from resource constraints? Yeah, that's of course the promise of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, for instance, and many organizations. Also, things like Walter Stahel has said before that it has the potential if we move to services that have more value and need fewer resources. So I think there's definitely the potential, but there is always a risk that people focus on the wrong things in policy an ambitious practice and they think, oh, we just do services because that's better from an environmental perspective. I think the intent really needs to be built in the business. And I will give you the example of Homey in a bit as an example of how we build in that intent in the business model. So that might help think about that. So the Kickstarting Circular Business Experimentation Project, so it was a 10-month collaborative project, action research with different types of businesses and focusing on the role and the process of circular business experimentation. And we did multiple experiments per case company. And we wanted to help them get more confidence in setting or creating this transition within their own businesses to become more circular, basically. Do we need to look into the B Corp discussion now, or?
No, I think Ian was just providing a little information. Nancy, sorry, back to the previous slide on the description of the project. So how is this project work funded?
It was largely was funded by ourselves by TU Delft out of my research budget and InnoBoost also out of their pro bono budget, basically. So it was really not a not-for-profit thing, mainly research type of money, non-profit type of effort to see, like, can we do this? How does it work? So it was really also an experiment, the setup of this project itself. So that's why it was only a short project. With a lot of volunteering work by various very nice people. We had a kickoff event in March about this project. So we launched it and we had a breakfast meeting and it was attended by 100 people just showing up at 7:30 a.m. for a breakfast meeting. So we really found that there was a lot of traction for this topic, which was really great.
It will be very interesting to see as you start to get the results, whether people think that the investment that they're making of just their time, whether they would be willing to pay for services to help them with this sort of thing. That's certainly on the mind of some of us in the room at any rate.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, we can exchange notes on that also with together with InnoBoost. But yeah, what we did find, so here are three examples of what we did. So the A-B split test, which I discussed before. We did one with mud jeans and different ways of connecting with the customer. So you see an example of the A-B split test done through Facebook with them to test two types of propositions. Then the second one is an example of Bugaboo again. And Avidas, which is a water company, and for both we did external visioning processes, one with a retailer and Bugaboo about a new value proposition, and with Avidas working with the local community on water scarcity type of issues. And on the right we see the company focused on farming and pig farming, and they did a co-creation session with different types of farmers on the well-being of pigs through new innovations. So very different types of businesses, which makes it also quite exciting, but promising outcomes, and all of them actually are taking forward some new steps based on these experiments. Then two other companies, with PRB, we also looked at their proposition and basically, as a sharing platform, what type of data they have and what new types of propositions we could be developing for them. And the same for the water company, again, we also look at new propositions we could develop. So for each company, I think we did somewhere between 3 to 5 interventions, and it all led to follow-up projects that they will be taking forward afterwards. So this is the business I'm involved in myself. It's called Homey. The website is homeypaperuse.com. I think homey.com was already taken by someone. So Homey was basically, it started off funding-wise from a small grant from the university because my work on business models, and I basically said, can I link the work on business models to something more tangible and practical and tested in customer homes. And the idea was to start with washing machines that are connected to the internet, and see whether you could actually stimulate customers to wash in a better way. That in itself might not be super novel, but we tried to combine different types of business models all at the same time. So for instance, first of all, we wanted to make sure that people had access to high quality appliances for an affordable price. So that's why we did a pure pay-per-use business model. So they only pay whenever the washing machine is used, somewhere between 1 and 2 euros, depending on the washing program. So also by the pricing of the wash, for instance, 30 degrees might be 1 euro, 90 degrees Celsius, sorry, I don't know what it is in Fahrenheit. So 90 degrees Celsius would be maybe 2 euros. So with the pricing, we also try to stimulate behavior change. We got a government grant of 250,000 euros to develop this proposition further because they were highly interested. We started with 5 customers and we now have 25, and the aim is to have 50 customers by the end of the year. And we test different types of propositions that we get from academic literature, like influencing people through the pay-per-use business model, through interventions like giving them information, social comparison, and maybe also setting defaults. So basically all our customers are sort of guinea pigs, but they know that they are guinea pigs, but it's interesting to really work on this business and really gain actual data on washing behavior and see how new business models can actually have an impact on behavior of customers. So this is a combination of trying to get high quality appliances in the home that can be repaired and reused because we keep the ownership, and also testing different ways to influence consumer behavior, and in this case it's washing behavior. And we're looking in different ways, maybe integrating more appliances, whether we should be a platform rather than focusing on appliances itself. So we're also trying to think about potential pivots for this business as well. And Manuel has a question. Hi, Nancy. Have you thought of the circular community as a larger system for the circular economy? What do you mean by the circular community? That's great. Circular community. I see some clarification coming in. So we have a subdivision of the Strong Sustainable Business Model Group, which is a circular conscious community as a co-housing. Yeah, I think, we did several student projects at TU Delft, and they just finalized this week, and there were also 2 propositions around indeed apartment blocks, but you could have apartment blocks where you have Homey as the offering in there. Student homes could also work, so yes, definitely it could be a very good way of doing this. And also the students did interviews with landlords and apartment block owners, and they think it's quite a good proposition, so that's also something that we're considering, looking into that market and seeing whether it's a good proposition. So yeah, good thought. Very brief overview. Business model experimentation. It's a systematic way to test and learn about new sustainable value propositions. It's something that works for startups and mature businesses. So I gave examples of both. For instance, Bugaboo is already quite well established as a business. I think the experiments could be used to achieve the best sustainability as well as business results. So with Homey, for instance, we're also looking at the pricing because we have differential pricing according to what we want to stimulate. We also did rebates, like for instance, get money back for a reduced energy bill, but customers found it too complicated. So we're also simplifying the pricing to have a better customer proposition, so we constantly work on those things. I think for large businesses, I think experimentation, they can really learn from what startups do. I think Eric Ries is also writing a book on that, how large businesses can use the lean startup approach. So I think he also sees that as very promising, and we actually applied it in a 3-year project in Cambridge as well. Unfortunately, we cannot disclose too many details. But we
some really neat approaches. I was wondering if, first of all, you drew them out on a canvas first to see how they would work, or did you just
more things from other businesses that are basically also using those types of methods. So I think it's very promising. Some tools and methods that you could use in this process, like first of all, of course, the Circular Business Book. There's 10 steps to circular business, and for each step in the book, we explain different tools and methods that you could use in the process. I won't read out all the steps, but maybe starting with step one, I think that's something, maybe a takeaway for everyone, and I think everyone probably has this quality who's in this room. So it starts with leadership, like personal leadership. Doesn't have to be top-down CEO leadership, but leadership in taking responsibility for a project within a business, starting your own business within your research, but starting something yourself and then setting out that vision and purpose to actually start testing and start setting up a new business and starting something new. So, and then, yeah, each of those steps are more about the practicalities of putting it in practice, up into even setting up contracts with new partners and how you do that in a circular economy context. So that's very, very briefly about the book. And you can see all.
Bob has a question for you, Nancy.
Yeah, I'm sorry. How much did you use a canvas to drive on these creative models? Which this one, for instance, for the whole book, or do you use a canvas to drive on these creative models?
So,
No, we did do interviews about our business for the Homey business itself. For instance, we did multiple business model canvases, sustainable business model canvases with a triple bottom line and a couple of workshops, so internal workshops. So it often starts with a canvas still as well as a starting point. So no, it didn't come out of the blue.
So if we look at the set of steps there, Nancy, which of the steps would you say the use of business modeling with a tool was helpful?
I think for each one in leadership, we also have tools. For instance, is it the 5 P's? I have the book here. I can actually get one. Quickly get it.
You can get the book.
Yeah, I'm back. So this is the book. So in each chapter, basically, you have different types of tools. So what I basically want to say, in some of them, we use things like the value mapping tool, like I will show in the next slide, that it's useful for visioning with different types of partners. But there's also tools, for instance, around how to make it, for instance, this one, the 5P model. Let's see. So how to link your personal life, so your private life, professional partners, and then public and the planet. So it's a 5P model by Schuler. And those types of models actually help you to link your personal interests and personal perceptions of what life should look like and link it to your public and business professional life as well. So that's more like a leadership type of tool on how to become a leader yourself. So for each type of step in the process, we have different types of canvases that you can use. Like for instance, in step 5, the visioning with partners, one of the tools you could use is the value mapping tool again. So for each step, we have different types of tools, I guess. How did you convince business to take part in the experimentation? Was the main incentive always economic? I think for the businesses, like especially for Mudgeens, they were like, how can we improve our sustainability proposition even more? For some, it was more, how can we combine sustainability and economics? So definitely there wasn't always a clear economic incentive. It was more about the long-term sustainability also in the economic sense of the business, like to make the business ongoing as well, and not a short-term thing if it was a cool startup. So it was also the long-term sustainability of the business. So another tool, the kickstarting circular business experimentation process. We talk a lot about sustainability and how to be more sustainable and better from that perspective. But I think the composing your circular story type of tool, the CEX template that Innobooth that's mainly been involved in developing, also lets you think about what is a good value proposition. So you go through different steps to come to a value proposition using a fairy tale analogy as well. So I think those types of tools can also help you rethink the value proposition to get more traction from a customer perspective as well. So it's not only how to be more sustainable, but also how to make it cool and attractive to the customer. Then this is a circular business experiment cycle that we developed, which is very much work in progress. I'm actually meeting with my co-authors tomorrow again about this process. But here we try to sort of disentangle where you would need to start ideally if you would do a sequence of different types of experiments. So we looked at academic literature, but also the things that we did and practice in the project. But often you start with a value proposition experiment because that's still the core of each business model. What is a product service offering? So a lot of the innovation starts there when you start the experimentation process. And then you have the sequence, you would go to the value deliver experiment, like that is also more the customer perspective, also more the channels part. So those are, I wouldn't want to say fuzzy, but that's an easy starting point because it links best to the value proposition. And then the value creation, those are more the practicalities, like what are the other things that you would need to do to make stuff happen, to make the business model happen in practice. And then the value capture, that's the financial picture. And to us, that actually often came later, once you had ironed out all the other things. And, well, after all those different steps, then you would be able to do a field experiment, a bigger experiment with new customer groups or with certain partners. And often, with some businesses, we had to start with the purpose as well, and really redefining for them, like, what would be their new purpose if they were to take into account all the sustainability parts if they weren't so progressive yet. So this is just a starting point, trying to map, like, some kind of order you would do and go on about if you were to start experimentation in your business. But of course, we're still looking at the data, testing it, and seeing what works best in terms of sequence, if there is actually a sequence that you could define for each type of business. So we'd welcome thoughts later on as well, maybe in the discussion too. Some more tools, the Value Hill, to visualize circular business strategies developed with some colleagues from different organizations, from different businesses. I personally thought it was quite a useful, easy way to show what is happening in the current linear economy on the left-hand side. On the one hand, you add value, but then you quickly destroy it when you throw away a product after just one customer use. And then in the circular economy, we try to retain value at each stage through the use, refurbishment, and remanufacturing, and eventually recycling. So this is just a visual aid to start thinking, and we also have used it in some workshops as well. Again, if you were to do a rapid experiment, so this approach that I will show you, I use in a workshop with different types of startups, where we only had 1 hour to really think about how to do experiments in a business. And in this project, they basically wanted to start and get going with setting up some experiments. So I just developed this very quick way to do it based on Osterwalder and Pinheur as well. So this one you might recognize from the Osterwalder recent book on value proposition design. So if you look at the rapid experiments part, it's a very nice way to start rethinking your business model. So this is something you can find in the book, but I just translated it into a very quick workshop-y thing that you could do in just an hour. So maybe if you were to start working with clients or in research, it could be a nice way to get going. what I proposed in this workshop that I did is people come in with some broad ideas already on where they want to go with their business, so they only need 5 minutes maybe to refine it a little bit, identify a main hypothesis, for instance, if you want to move from a product to a service. An assumption might be it would only be our most expensive product in the range that it could work with a service contract. And then there could be a test, like could you set up a mock website for this leasing service and see how many people click on it. And the simple analysis would then be the number of customers that click on this lease service. So this is an exercise that I've tried with a group of people, I think we're 50 people. And yeah, I think it actually worked well that in the end we actually had, each group had some ideas to take experimentation forward. So it also showed that it doesn't have to be too complicated if you break up an issue in a couple of tangible mini exercises. So this is something that I tried and maybe want to test and try more and experiment with myself in other contexts. And then, of course, you can start ranking those ideas. If you have multiple experiments, what would be most feasible and what would have the most positive impact on sustainability? And now this is actually, I think, one of my final slides. So what is my work in progress at the moment? I want to do more of those circular, sustainable business model experimentation processes with different types of businesses. And using those tools like the business experimentation cycle, value mapping, value mill, other experimentation tools and methods. With HOMI, we're looking at the data and the experimentation process. So I'm trying to write this massive map of different types of experiments we do and the different types of sequences, so other people can also learn it if they want to set up a business in the future, wanting to do good and do experiments to do it in the best way. Yeah, we're also rising up to kickstarting circular business project in a more academic paper and similar to the HOBI work. And yeah, I'm looking forward to hearing also your ideas, and any ideas are welcome, any reactions, and quite curious to hear and questions. And these are all the sources, but you will find them online as well.
Lovely.
So, yeah, ideas welcome from your side.
So I'll start in the room here. Ideas, things that perhaps in from your own experience or your own backgrounds that you'd like to put on the table. I have one in mind, but I'll let other people go first, and we'll take some, if folks online, if you've got some ideas in response to Nancy's question, please feel free to speak up or type them into the chat box.
I have a couple. Hi Nancy, my name's Panos. First of all, have you I thought at all about the evaluating impacts in terms, for example, using life cycle assessment tools and things like that, or?
Okay. Yeah, so I worked with a group with some people from BTT as well on doing some quick life cycle assessments of business model development while you're still in process of developing those. So we have some work that is under review on that. I have to say it was developed with people who are life cycle experts. But the work is still highly qualitative. So I think there's still quite a bit of work that could be done in this space.
So it's like a streamlined LCA, like a very...
Exactly, that is the idea, yeah.
Okay. And basically, it's not really an idea, it's like something I was thinking while you were talking, and was this slide about what was circular, sustainable, and, you know, elongating the change and all that. So could it be, and I can't claim to be an expert in circular economy, but could it be that, you know, the higher the system you look at and the higher the circuit you might have to close, or, you know, the more sustainable it gets. And while I was thinking that, I then wanted to pose a question, you know, when you're talking about experiments, how does scale come into play? So, I mean, I guess it's a different thing to just reuse some scrap materials in your production, and it's a completely different thing to go, you know, to the industrial symbiosis, you know, of having multiple circuits being closed, you know, at a very higher system level. So what would your comment be on that?
Yeah, Yes, I think what I learned from going through those experimentation processes with different businesses, it's more about the confidence that they gain in that. For instance, when you sell products on a fast pace and that's your business model, fast sales business model, and you suddenly need to go to a service type of model or a leasing model or more premium products, it's just the confidence that you get through experimentation and seeing successes in things you thought weren't possible at all. I think that's the starting point of a transition in the business. So in that sense, I think experimentation could be a catalyst for bigger projects in a business. So it gives much more evidence than an Excel file that says, I calculated here that this potential business could be this big, but actually seeing it in practice through a website or even a small test with real customers, I think it can be very powerful to start that transition in the business.
So we have two questions online, and then I think we have at least one more in the room here. Do you want to, so Nigel just said the 5P leadership model, I think that's in your book, right?
It's in the book, I can find a page again. No, so it's, well, the most simple way to explain it is that it's the 5 P's, I don't know by heart exactly, but the middle P is the personal life. Like you have different ways in which you operate in your life. So you have your personal life, your private circle with your family, professional life, like where you operate in business, and maybe your public life, like when you go outside and how you behave. And sometimes people have this disconnect, so they might, at the extreme part, work for oil company, but actually also in their personal life have a much more sustainability type of vision. So this book is about bringing those, becoming more aware of your personal values and what your rationale is for how you actually want to behave and how you can actually link your personal to your professional and your public life as well much better. So there's no disconnect between those different types of areas in your life. And that's a way to create more leadership and maybe also more happiness in your overall life, because it's not so disconnected. So in different ways, it's quite a nice model, I think.
Nigel, the link to the book website, if you click on the first link in the chat, there's a link there to Nancy's book website, and you can go there and order a copy.
CircularCollaboration.com is the website.
Bob has a question about money.
How important was the cost-benefit analysis or profit projections to the assessment of whether an innovative approach should be tried? I think with the large business we worked with, we tried many things that didn't have any business case whatsoever, no clear business case, almost an anti-business case, which was really, really quite funny to me. And to my biggest surprise, one of the things that didn't have any financial business case, but a clear, somehow the people in the business loved the idea and they saw that the customers loved it, but it didn't gain any financial business case. But it's all about creating this love brand. It's also one of those trendy things. And if customers, if the business has a feeling that that's the case, that it generates maybe more intangible value, although it might detract somehow financially from the business, I can still see that things led to positive development despite of that. So sometimes there was even an seemingly anti-business case, but then still businesses would invest in it for the long term. Sorry, it's highly hypothetical, but it actually happened. But I cannot really give the detail. Maybe in a year's time or so, when the company wants to speak a bit more clearly about it.
I'm reminded very much of a presentation we had just before Christmas by another member, Simon Robinson, on customer experiences with Soul, S-O-U-L. And he was talking very much about this idea that if you're going to engage your stakeholders in order to be profitable, you may have to do things to develop those relationships which are almost antithetical to the profit motive. So in which case, you know, is that going after the profit motive or not? It's very hard to say. Very hard to say. Andrew in the room here has a question.
Yeah, I'm just connecting the dots to our presentation from last month from Lorraine Smith at Volans, the Breakthrough Business Models. And she had like five characteristics of breakthrough business models, one of which was circular. And she articulated a definition that really struck me at the time, and I'm just kind of thinking about it again. Her definition of circular, or their definition, was sustaining inputs and outputs at their highest value, both technical and biologically. When we talk about recycling or even circular economy, it's always this concept, or usually it's this downsizing. Things become less and less valuable. Kind of raising the bar, I think, is really changes the paradigm here. So do you have any thoughts about that highest value and how you actually implement that is, I think, the challenge.
Yeah, so I think clever sustainability leader type of companies and organizations understand that that retaining the product at the highest value is the key thing. Even the city of Amsterdam, there's a project on cities as well. They have a project called product to product, so keeping products at the highest level. So I think there's a will, and there's really an understanding that that's the right way forward. But how to then put it in practice? Can you imagine a city, for instance, a circular city that wants to keep all the products at the highest product level, would need to connect with so many OEMs to actually make that happen, from cars to books to anything. So it's highly complex, but I do think that's the main aim of many of the sustainability leaders that we have at the moment.
I wonder if I find your three-dimensional model to assess the journey towards circularity really interesting, and I wonder if but it's also interesting that it doesn't pick up on the biological nutrient versus technical nutrient characteristic that's been identified in Bowen's talk, and obviously came from McDonald's work. I wonder if there's some integration there of those two ideas that could inform some pathways.
I didn't present everything, but in the journal paper where this diagram appears, we do discuss the technical as well as the biological cycle. But my personal expertise, I would say, is more in the technical cycle, although. I'm trying to maneuver in the different spaces, but
And do you see those two as being? Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I would love to speak with the previous speaker about that and maybe compare notes on this topic. It would be quite interesting. Yeah, but you had another question.
I was just going to say, so do you see the biological and the technical nutrients as being a completely different way of looking at them? Circularity from the three dimensions indicated on that diagram, or do you see those as highly interdependent with one another?
Yeah, when you look at the Ellen MacArthur butterfly diagram, which is a bit more complicated, you can clearly see that the strategies within that are quite different. But I think as the big strategies, like slowing loops, when you think about food, I think the most simple thing you can do is minimize food waste and minimize avoidance behavior, basically, not overbuying. So I think that would be a basic strategy that still applies. And then the closing loops, maybe it has more of a link to composting and those types of areas. So I think you can definitely make analogies, but definitely the strategies within that need more thought and are sometimes complicated because you're dealing with food, basically, or other biological products.
So I had one question in terms of the work in progress and next steps. I think I picked up from the case studies that you presented, and thank you for sharing such rich case studies. They're actually fascinating. is that you've been focused on the connection between the company and its one step up or down its value network. Mm-hmm. Have you thought about it, or have you come across situations where you're trying to conduct an experiment which has to cross more elements of the value chain in order to create the circularity?
Yeah, so one of my PhD researchers at TU Delft is looking into collaboration across value chains. In the book, we have the example of interface networks, where Interface is working with the Zoological Society of London, as well as Aquafil, and also local communities in the Philippines to take fishing nets from the sea and actually turn them into new carpets. So that's already quite a complex network. So yes, definitely there's different types of business models and value chains that cut across a longer chain, and we're investigating that through case studies, but it's much more difficult to do that. It's much easier to look at one partner, but if you look at the partners of those partners, it easily becomes quite complex. But yeah, definitely we're also collecting case studies on that, and I think it's a very good avenue for more work.
And is that something that is that work actively searching out opportunities to do some collaborative value network design?
Yeah, that's the ideal thing. So at the moment we're mainly doing case studies, but the ideal thing is to collaborate with businesses, and we're looking at different ways to do that, also to look more upstream and downstream the supply chain of different partners. So ideally we would do some action type of research as well with them.
So a group of us here are really interested in doing some large scale experimentation around value network design. Do you know René Rohrbeck at Aarhus University in Denmark?
No, maybe I should speak with him.
So he did a study in the German renewable energy industry using the business model canvas as the design tool to do some collaboration, collaborative value network design. And we're looking for an opportunity to see if we can do something similar. We've got some opportunities in the district geothermal space and also in the power space, looking for an opportunity to do that experimentation, but with a tool that actually includes the social and environmental dimensions, not just the economic dimension. And so that would be a project that we would be very interested in collaborating with others on. And so I think I have spoken to René briefly, it's a few years ago now, about the work that he did. But maybe this is something for an offline conversation that we could do.
There's one project that might be linked to it, and we're starting that in June. It's called Zero Brine. Maybe not a super sexy name, but it's about it's an EU project about industrial symbiosis networks with the Rotterdam port, AkzoNobel, and some other big businesses trying to set up more creative industrial symbiosis networks, but it's more focused on the economic and environmental parts of sustainability, but also complex value chains. So maybe there's also some good links between that EU project and yours. So it would be quite interesting.
Sure. Yeah, that would be interesting. I'll send you. I've been sharing that paper with a few people, so I can send that to you, Nancy.
Yeah, please do. I'm always happy to meet. Yeah.
So while you're doing that, if I can come in on Andrew's question, because I think that, are you working with the Penny Sue Collection?
I know them. They're not part of a particular conversation.
Oh, they're not.
They're not.
So I'm offering it up in terms of a circular model in terms of apparel. She's going from fiber to upcycling. I don't know if you know the term shoddy knits, but shoddy is using her scraps of organic denim to color her unbleached yarns to give color. So in that case, she would be upscaling waste in a way that it is keeping the higher value to it. So if you look up the Peggy Sue Collection, she's only in year two, but it's really interesting in terms of her process. I'd like to introduce her into the systems area or to the systems group, just to show how she is taking agricultural or agricultural in fibers as opposed to food. And I think that for your, if you're still working with mud, you'd be of interest to them as well in terms of just the denim piece.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah, I'm also working with a company called Reblend. So they take post-consumer mixed materials and turn it into high-value garments again. So they find a way to create yarn out of mixed textile fiber. So there might be many links with this organization. So we'd be very happy to be connected. I think people are...
I know we have a few people dropping off. Any other final...
Final thought of the night.
Final thoughts of the night? Okay, well, Nancy, thank you very much for this presentation. That's very, very helpful. And
a lively discussion, yeah.
Absolutely, and I think we have a few follow-ups, so look forward to doing that. And I'll post the links to the presentation and to the recording into the LinkedIn group chat in the next few minutes.
Yeah, cool. Well, thank you for listening all at this, for me, late night.
Yes, indeed. Thank you for staying up for us. We appreciate that very much.
Have a great rest of the afternoon.
Okay, thanks very much, Nancy.
Okay. Bye-bye.
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 Bye-bye.